Richard, here's another for you.
Oh, yes, of course, it's the flag of the European Union. We know that. Nigel Farage, and he's on his way to a public ceremony. Gays are allowed to get married for the since Sunday. That's fantastic. Really good news, brilliant. And this couple here are one of the first to actually, you know, say the rights. They're now a husband and husband. Fantastic news.
Oh, that's lovely.
It's a lovely story.
A lot of people think it won't last, but I'm all for it.
I think so. They've had a couple of arguments, a couple of them in public, but, you know, they'll get together as a couple. They'll be absolutely fine.
I think it's the story about Nick Clegg and Nigel Farage having a TV debate.
And who do you think won?
I don't think either of them are truly winners, are they? I think you've got best loser.
According to Donald McIntyre in The Independent, journalists had been briefed that Nick Clegg was going to do something unusual during the debate. What was it?
He was going to show some passion.
Get emotional.
On a space hopper.
And did he get emotional?
He got a bit emotional.
He used his hands a lot, didn't he? Sort of, you know, just to show emotion and stuff. And he took his shirt off as well, I think, didn't he?
As far as I understand it. They wrestled like men. I quite enjoyed the debate. I think because of the way I watched it, because I didn't watch the pictures, I just had the audio. Then I turned the volume right down. And genuinely, I enjoyed it.
Well, it's slightly odd. You're the Deputy Prime Minister, and you're taking on live television a man who hasn't got one MP. And he wins. Mm. You know, this is supposed to be equal status.
Apparently, Clegg told Farage, "You're making things up to make a point," to which Farage replied, "You've done pretty well out of it."
Did you watch the debate last night?
Yes, I did. It was great. It was No. You caught me out mid-lie, mid-question. No, I didn't see it, no. Was it good?
So am I the only one who could bear to watch?
Yes.
Well, it was great.
What was your favourite bit, Ian?
The bit at the beginning when you realised Cameron hadn't turned up. That was very good. And then Clegg hadn't come either.
Yeah.
So it meant that everyone attacked Ed Miliband. He'd managed to get a platform where all the other people could say, "You're useless." And he couldn't say it's the Tories' fault because they weren't there. So it was a slightly unbalanced debate.
But what do you think about David Dimbleby's frank confession at the end? I mean, did you guess?
Ill-advised.
Ill-advised, yeah. I agree, I am.
Even though we didn't see all of the debate, let's have a look at the highlights.
There just seems to be a total lack of comprehension on this panel, and indeed amongst this audience, which is a remarkable audience, even by the left-wing standards of the BBC. I mean, this lot's pretty left-wing.
Hang on a second. Let me just say one thing. Yeah. This is an audience that has been carefully chosen, not by the BBC, but by an independent polling organisation to represent the balance between all parties.
It's never a great
idea. Very good.
It's a very good tactic. Attack your audience.
Was it a wise move to pick a fight with David Dimbleby?
And the BBC audience. He's been a bit rattled, isn't he? 12 months ago, he was seen as this sort of man that was going to remake English politics and all this sort of stuff, and now he's just some bloke moaning that everybody's against him.
Who would you rather have a fight with, John? David Dimbleby or Jeremy Paxman?
Glass jaw, Dimbleby.
No, I think that...
He'd go straight down. Paxman, he'd be like a bulldog. You'd have to shoot him in the end. He'd keep coming. And another thing, Prime Minister. Last week we weren't on because it was children with knees. Mm. And we had... But I obviously have not read a paper, so this just sounds all so absurd.
Oh, there's more.
Is there more?
Yeah, Trump's proposed to the Queen. And she's accepted, and the wedding is next year. They're going to have it in Trump Tower. It's going to be fantastic.
Oh, I look forward to it.
Yeah, I'm best man. Are you? He hasn't actually appointed him.
But via Twitter. I mean, that's real, isn't it?
The president isn't actually allowed to appoint our ambassador yet.
No. Thankfully
not. Twitter. If he does it on Facebook, it's legally binding. Oh, right,
yeah. So it was a late night tweet from Trump. Do you remember roughly what it said?
It said that many people think that Nigel Farage would make an excellent ambassador between the UK and the US, or
that's
something
many
along
in the sense
form.
Of yeah. one.
I responded to Donald Trump and I said, name them.
This is exactly what he said. Many people would like to see Nigel Farage represent Great Britain as their ambassador to the United States. He would do a great job.
Donald Trump doesn't even follow Nigel Farage on Twitter, which is a massive digital slap
that's
in the face.
Really?
Yeah, he doesn't even follow him, so he doesn't think he's that great a job. He doesn't think he's got top bants online.
Do you know?
Can anyone remember? You remember Christopher Mayer, who was Tony Blair's ambassador to the US?
Yeah.
Do you remember what his instruction was?
Yeah. Get as drunk as possible and then avoid everybody.
He was pretty nearly that.
Was it?
He was told to get as far up George Bush's arse as you can.
Exactly. It was exactly. We want you to go.
Is he allowed to use crampons? Is he?
We want you to get up the arse of the White House and stay there. So that's the brief. Actually, maybe Nigel Farage is qualified.
Well, Blair did it himself. He didn't actually need an ambassador.
Now, who'd like to see a picture of Farage, quite possibly the happiest moment in his life? I think that's the door into Trump Tower.
It hinges. Is fantastic. Have you seen the pictures of inside? It's sort of late Gaddafi. The day. Perhaps early Saddam, but it's... it's a riot of vulgar dictator chic. It is.
Meanwhile, how is Theresa May's special relationship with Trump coming along?
Very good.
Very good. He said to her, if you're ever over, do drop in.
Let me know.
Made that up. That was it.
If you're coming over, let me know.
Know.
That's what you say to the couple you don't like on holiday, isn't it? right, and that welcome interruption means it's time once again for a bonus buzzer election round, so let's get started. And the category is... Where am I? Where am I? I'm UKIP parliamentary candidate for Birmingham, Harjinder Singh, but where am I?
He's in the street.
He's in the street.
Well, he is, of course, standing near Junction 7 of the M6. He's waving at passing cars. He's been doing this 13 hours a day for the last 2 weeks in a bid to win votes. Locals in a nearby pub were asked if they were going to vote for UKIP. What did they all reply?
No.
No! There we are. Fingers on buzzers. Here is your next question.
Are we allowed to do jokes about UKIP? I thought we'd been referred to the Kent police.
Yeah, after last week's show.
Mm. And the police were very rightly quite surprised. I mean, usually they're investigating UKIP, not following up complaints. But anyway, well, I hope we're going to be jolly careful, because it's the Representation of the People's Act. So if you make jokes about Farage or UKIP, they could well complain.
Well, he's already threatening the BBC, isn't he, to slash the licence fee as a revenge for that audience on the opposition.
But it's funny when anyone says that, you know, there were some pretty racist jokes made at, say, the UKIP gala, he says, oh, it was a joke, we're going to have censorship now. I think the Kent police are going to be round again.
Yeah. Next, here's UKIP parliamentary candidate for the West Midlands, Claire Braund. Can you tell me what happened next?
Did she start singing, Let It Go, Let It Go?
You are so close. I mean, that is almost exactly right. Yes, let's...
No!
Let's just have a look.
This is the rhythm of the night. Oh, yeah. The rhythm of the night. This is the rhythm of my life. My life, oh yeah, the rhythm of my life.
Why?
Why? Ian? That's a no from me.
What is the parties on the poll is for the latest YouGov European election poll?
But 38% UKIP.
It's 31% UKIP. Oh. Labour 28 and Tories 19. Were you surprised by that, Bridget?
Yes, I thought it had gone up 7 points today.
You haven't been watching carefully enough.
Oh, has it gone back down again?
Well, I check it more frequently than you.
Have you got a Google alert?
Yes, I have, yes.
That's despite... That's, I mean, UKIP come in for constant bashing around the clock. No matter what you do, they get stronger.
Mm.
It's like... there's no point attacking them. It's like trying to piss in a lake constantly. To make it go away.
Yeah.
What are Nuttall's plans?
To hold the government to a hard Brexit.
Mm.
And yes, if Mrs. May Nuttall at says. Any point goes soft, Nuttall will be there.
Yeah.
That's the motto. Don't go soft, Nuttall's watching.
Yeah.
We definitely want a hard Brexit. It's got to be hard to be good. Everybody knows that.
This is pornographic.
And he offers a pano this year.
Of course, there are the shockingly high EU immigration figures that have just come out.
Yeah, record EU immigration figures today.
They're all coming over!
There's some in here, Suzanne! Take cover under the desk! Oh, my God! Strange accents and everything!
See, this is the fundamental misunderstanding about UKIP. We're not anti-immigration at all. We just want to... It's true, it's true.
You see, that's the problem with the message. It hasn't really got across.
No.
Oh, it's Maria Miller. She's gone, going into a house, not hers.
Oh, she's changed her outfit.
No, there's another house. That's probably hers. Oh, and it's a duck house. That's where she put her parents to live. No, he doesn't think that's funny either.
She's resigned.
She's resigned. She's gone. She said it was because she'd brought in gay marriage and the evil press were out to get her. But, you know, that's unfair, because, yeah, we were. But she did actually threaten The Telegraph when they brought it up. One of her assistants said, "My boss is in charge of Leveson and press behaviour." The reason she went is the public are furious. They've had enough of MPs claiming expenses, and it's very damaging for everyone, isn't it, Nigel?
Nigel, what do you think about her resigning?
On the basis she doesn't even know where she lives, wouldn't have thought she's fit to be in the cabinet, would you? So I'd say good riddance, frankly. I think it's absolutely disgusting, all these elected politicians using all these expenses to better themselves. It's disgraceful, isn't it, Ian?
It is absolutely disgraceful, Mr. Kettle.
So why was Cameron so reluctant to get rid of her?
He didn't want to look weak. He didn't want to lose one of the women in his cabinet. And he doesn't like being told what to do. And he's indecisive. And he's hopeless.
It's not like the real world, is it? She's sort of lost her job, but she's just gone to the back benches. So it's not like... It's like school. She had to stand up and say, "Sorry for my attitude," and then got told to sit in the back of the class.
She was a woman who went to a comprehensive, so he's done pretty well to communicate with her up till now, let's face it.
And in her resignation, she apologised. She said she was leaving because she'd become a distraction.
Yes.
Which is quite... Cats in tights on the internet are a distraction.
The press kept commissioning opinion polls, all which said she should quit. This is something David Cameron had actually told his MPs to think about when the expenses scandal broke in 2009. Subject yourself to the Daily Mail test. How would this look on the front page?